I would like to see that.
What do you mean? There already is one. This last voting season was so dramatic. So dramatic.
Who's watching Designated Survivor?
Is it a show?
No, it's like a series.
I know what it is. It's a drama.
I often wonder why they started this, because of Trump, maybe. they're predicting what's going to happen in the future, you know? Like, well, let's get people prepared.
Did you guys see at President Trump's inauguration how the guy with the green jacket, you guys didn't see that? He's all, no! You guys didn't see that?
Well,
I was at
work.
It's so funny. I'm sure if you just Google search Trump inauguration green jacket or something like that, it's so funny because they're like the 45th or 6th or whatever president of the United States. And as soon as they said, he's like, no. And so they did all kinds of remixes. One's a metal remix and it's all, no. And then there's another one that has the from the Celine Dion from Titanic. Near, far. That one, you know, it's just so funny. Okay, anyways. So, okay, last week, the question of the week was, what is the church? What is it? What makes us the church? What defines us?
People in the church.
Huh? Okay, and what defines that? Like, what marks do you look for in a person? You know what I mean? You know what I'm asking? Like,
the fruit of the spirit type things?
Is that what you think?
I think she was more wanting you to define your question.
I'm more wanting for you to think biblically and in your own personal idea. Uh-huh. What you think defines the church. As Diane already mentioned, as a group of believers, what defines that?
Worship the same God.
Okay. All right. What else?
I mean, we serve the same God. No.
That we all pray together.
Okay. Prayer. What else?
We're here all for the same purpose.
Okay. And that purpose being?
Serving God.
Okay.
And serving others. Spreading the good
God.
News.
Okay. Zach, what's that?
Doing the will of God.
Okay. Being?
His servants.
Okay. All right. That's fine. I wasn't trying to put you on the spot. I just wanted you to elaborate.
Love.
Okay. Anything else?
Compassion.
Okay. Nicole, it looked like you were about to say something.
In my eyes, kind of family.
Okay. Mm-hmm. All right. Do you want to elaborate any more on that, or do you think that's good enough?
I can't think of any more to elaborate.
Okay, that's fine. That's fine. Anything else? Keep thinking about this, okay? Mm-hmm. So it's definitely not defined by clothes or image. Right? Now, that's actually kind of an important statement, though, because, like, if you're familiar with, like, the Orthodox traditions and stuff, their ministers wear those robes, those priestly garments and stuff. Jews, for instance, still wear their priestly garments, you know what I mean? Different kinds, and not important. And then a lot of times, even in Protestant churches, like, not so much at our church, because our church is so laid back and the community is so laid back, but in a lot of Protestant churches, the pastor will be required to wear certain things, like, you know, ties and stuff like that. Different things like that. But if you actually stop and think about it, you know, especially I grew up in the church world, and that was one of the things is, you know, dress up, it's Sunday.
You can't wear a hat.
And you can't wear a hat. You know, all these different things. But if you actually stop and think about what is the church, it's defined. It's not defined as the way that you dress. No. You know what I mean?
Uh-huh.
And I think that one reason why that's important is because when the church started, it didn't start as a club. No. It started as people joining together. And gradually over the course of time, we made it into a club. Mm-hmm. And with clubs, there's dress codes. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? You're required to wear a certain thing and do a certain, you know, as if wearing the clothes would make you more or less respectable. And obviously that's not true, but at the time, especially during, you know, the 30s and 40s in the American church, it was just this idea, you know, that somehow it does. And it's not meant to be out on their own. That's another thing that defines the church. Like Nicole mentioned about it being a family. That's absolutely true. It's not meant to be something where you're in isolation. These aren't the things that define us. Oh, I'm a Christian. I just don't go to church. Well, you know what I mean? That's kind of an oxymoron, because Christianity at its core is unity. And also, here's another thing. A lot of times people will claim Christianity, but Christians by nature have to have a teachable spirit. What does that mean? That means when the pastor preaches, you listen. When somebody is correcting you on something, even if you don't agree with them, you listen. See, because you're not hard of heart. You may not agree with somebody, but you're still listening because you have a teachable spirit. You know what I mean? You know what I mean? It can be compared to a child who the parent reprimands the child, and they actually listen to what their parent says. They might get irritated. They might, you know, whatever. They don't fully agree, whatever. But they at least listen to what the parent has to say, as compared to the other child who purposely goes against what the parent says.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I think that's a good thing. Christians by nature have to be teachable. It's something that as the Holy Spirit works in us, and we're going to be looking at the Holy Spirit starting next month. So as the Holy Spirit works in us, we have a more teachable spirit. Another thing is striving towards a higher purpose in all things. Zach mentioned this, and I think Diana mentioned it too. The idea of having a purpose, having a reason, having something that unites us, you know, kind of like we're heading in the same direction, you know, and those are definitely things that define the church. You know, it really defines the church. So I really want you guys to keep this in your head and just keep thinking about that. What is the church? What is the church? Because sometimes we get these like little things going on that just in our minds, where it's like comfort zones, and this is, we know what we believe, we're firm in that. But always challenge that. Always challenge that. Am I doing this church thing right? See what I mean? Or am I going through motions? Am I doing this loving people thing right? Or am I just going through the motions? You know what I mean? Because God doesn't want us to live a life that's just dull and the same thing repeated over and over again. He wants us to live a full life, and that full life is going to be found in serving people. That full life is going to be found in seeking God with the whole heart. That full life is going to be found in just putting God first in everything, and putting our needs second to whatever God has planned. That's where you're going to find happiness and fulfillment in your life. So anyways, there's just some ideas of what defines the church. So we're going to go through a series of situations of conflict in the church, and I want you guys to answer what you think, what you would do at that time. Okay, you don't have to answer every single question, just if you have something that you think. Okay, but before we do that, have you ever been involved in a conflict in the church? I mean, if you've been in there for long enough, you probably will have.
Many times.
Many times. Me too. Many times. Gracie, Nicole?
What do you mean by church conflict?
It's kind of one of those things that you know when it happens. You know what I mean? Like,
it disrupts the whole church,
yeah,
basically.
Yeah.
It's not just something between
a yeah. few people. Yeah. I'm not talking about a tiff.
No.
Like, oh, I got mad at this person. I'm talking about, like, okay, well, this person said that this person, and then there's a huge fight that broke out, and everybody's mad at everybody, and just like, wow, where'd that come from? You know what I mean?
Yeah. Not sure.
Does anybody have anything that they want to share? I'm gonna go first. Okay, try to not, don't use specific things. Yeah, and don't use people's names or anything like that. I was at a church where, I mean, I'm not saying that I'm innocent in this situation. I'm not trying to say that. And really, it was just kind of the way that the church worked. There was little to no communication and fellowship. Everything was about gossip and backbiting. So, you know, it shouldn't come as like, I was a martyr. No, it was happening to everybody. I was at this church, and there just got some rumors going on about me. And, I mean, I was too naive and ignorant at the time to... I would have probably gossiped too. I was just too ignorant at the time. I was kind of sidetracked because that's when I started having panic attacks. And I was having depression, all these different things. So I really just didn't have time to focus on it. So when people were spreading these rumors about me, I did that thing, like, if you've seen Arrested Development on season 4, where he just stares off and he's like, "Hello, darkness, my old friend." You know, I was just so out of it at the time that that's why I didn't... I'm not saying that I was better than them. I was just too out of it to gossip and complain. But these rumors started going on about me. And, I mean, I endured past those rumors, but I really wasn't there the whole time because of the whole thing with the panic and the depression and all that stuff. And so what ended up happening was... eventually, I went off to college, and, you know, I left the situation, and I tried to come back and, you know, make things better at the church. But the problem was that the church itself wasn't really based on prayer. It was more based on – I don't even know what it was based on. People would come for a few months to a few years, and they would cause as much problems as they could, and then they would leave. It was a very confusing situation. You know what I mean? Like – just discord everywhere. But anyways, I ended up leaving, and when I left, it wasn't like I was dying as a martyr. I didn't do anything, you know, to go out on a good note. It's just something where it's just something that it had no purpose for me. I didn't learn anything from it, and it was just a complete, you know what I mean? It felt like it was a complete waste of my time and a complete failure. And so when I moved on, it was hard for me to get involved in other church situations. In fact, we were at there in Texas, and there was actually it was a really nice church in Red Oak, which is just north of Waxahachie, between Waxahachie and Dallas, and it was a nice church. But I just didn't really want to get involved, so I started making up excuses as to what was wrong with the church. You know, like one thing was the worship was terrible. It actually wasn't very good. It was pretty terrible. But I mean, it wasn't anything worth leaving the church over. I just didn't want to get involved in a church. You see what I mean? And then eventually, after I came back from college, I tried to get back into that church and you know, thinking that I could fix it, you know. And the truth is, it wasn't something that I could have fixed in the first place. And so I just kind of wandered around, and then I eventually ended up down here. And you know, it's just something that I learned from after the fact. But it was something that always stuck with me. Like, is there any way I could have dealt with this different? Is there any way I could have learned more from this? Because I felt like it was, at the time, I felt like it was a waste of time. You know, like the ministry was for nothing. Any other stories you guys want to share?
I don't know if it would be considered a conflict.
Okay.
But one of the churches I went to when I was younger, if I didn't do things a certain way, they would get mad.
Yeah.
If I didn't read out of a certain version of the Bible, they would get mad.
KJV?
It just...
Was it King James?
Yeah. I knew it. The school I went to was NIV, so there was the big battle there.
I gotcha.
Just wasn't good. But it took me about 3 or 4 years after that to start going back to church again and be comfortable with it.
Yeah.
Because I was so scared it was going to happen again.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Anybody else? No. Okay. And my hope in this is that you understand that everybody, you know, goes through conflicts in church, and it's nothing to feel like, you know, it's the end of the world. You know, it's bad and it's hard when it happens. But the point is that we learn from it, that we submit it to God, and we just kind of move on in our spirits. Because sometimes when those conflicts do happen, we just kind of hold on to them for dear life. You know what I mean? And those don't have to define us. You know, I could have gotten involved in that church in Red Oaks and actually had a good time there. But instead, I spent my entire college career out of church. And I just didn't care. I didn't care to go back. I didn't like Christians. I didn't like church. I just hated the whole thing. Like, I was fine with God. I just really hated his people. And I know that's a bit of a contradiction. We've been talking about discipleship, and part of discipleship is loving people. But I really didn't. And, yeah. You see someone wear a hat in the church, what do you do?
and slap it off their hand.
And you say something really mean when you do it, too. Have respect in the house of God!
Don't you know any better?
Oh my gosh, yes.
Lord,
I've actually heard these things. It would be funny if well, no, it's funny. Yeah. Yeah, okay, yeah, it's still funny.
Or have some respect, you know.
Yeah, yeah. Does anybody have any ideas?
Well, you know,
go up there, play
if it bothers you, and I think you have to look at society too.
Uh-huh.
You know, like in church, if there's like more older people and all that stuff, and if it bothers you, I think you should be quiet because, how do I put it? I think God will take care of the situation
uh-huh.
himself. You know, God will speak to that person's heart, you know, like, instead of, you know, like, hey, you know, I'm making somebody else gossip inside your mind or sin inside your mind, so I'm going to stop this.
I get
you. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's kind of like one of those, like, I'm going to stop this because I don't want to make my brother sin against something, you know?
Right, right, right.
So I think God will take care of situations like this. The way you just have to be patient.
Yeah. patient what?
Patient?
I'm not familiar with that word.
Reject.
I made it up.
It's going to be in her Braille dictionary.
And my answer was to do nothing.
That's what I would do.
Yeah. And I think you were kind of on that too. Sometimes people say, well, what if there's other people in the church who are offended by that? And for that, I would say...
Find something better and get offended.
Well, what I was going to say was, you don't have to take up someone else's offense. Well, that offends me. I'm sorry, but I'm still not getting involved with your problem. You see what I mean? Like, yeah. That's my own personal take. Sometimes people feel like they have to be the intercessor, you know. I need to go ask them to take off their hats and this other person doesn't get mad. And, you know, some people are just like that. I don't know. You know, I wouldn't say that's necessarily wrong. I mean, you're just going to end up, it's going to blow up in your face, though, you know.
And, you know, older people, they're just raised that way, mentality.
Yeah.
So, I mean,
yeah.
That's where you're going to see a lot of problems.
Yeah. I personally try not to wear hats too often inside of a church just because, you know, well, you never know when an old person's going
to
be there.
It was out of respect that you were raised not to have any...
Right. But once again, that's something that's gonna die off, though, because...
Not even in school that...
Right, right. But that's something that's going to die off because, like, for instance, in the Jewish custom, they actually were required to wear a hat. When they were doing their priestly things. Have you ever seen the priestly garments? There's a hat. There's a headgear that goes over their head.
Yeah.
They were required to wear hats.
Yeah.
And then other people at different times said, okay, yes, hats are demanded of God. And other people, oh, it's a respect to not have the hat on. Eventually it'll die off. You know what I mean? This is one of those things that, whatever.
Yeah.
But I think the moral of the story here is don't get offended about it yourself. But if somebody else does, like...
Love it.
Right, and just do it out of respect for them, because I'm not going to lead you to offense.
Uh-huh.
But otherwise, I'm not going to worry about this one right now. You know what I mean?
Right.
Someone comes to you obviously bothered and confides in you something that the pastor did. What do you do? I saw the pastor. What do you do?
Well, I would say, let's go talk to the pastor about this.
Yeah.
Okay.
Right.
I think that instead you should get some other people to join on your side, though.
Wow.
I would ask them, well, did you talk to the pastor about it? No? Oh, well, maybe you talk to them about the me.
Okay, hold on. Let's back up. Okay, let's say you ask me that. I'm the person who did this, okay? And I say, yes, but he just won't listen to reason. He just got such a hard heart.
Well,
not as spiritual as I am.
Maybe
you should be the pastor.
If you're so spiritual, you need to, you know, forgive him.
I like that answer. If you're so spiritual, forgive him.
That's so smart. You go girl.
That one. Yeah. Need it at some point.
Yeah, write that down somewhere. Maybe you just keep writing it over and over again on the wall.
You're so special. Forgive him.
Well, you know, we have a complaint box over there. Just write it in and just put it all in there.
I can't find it. It's the little trash. It looks like a trash can because it is a trash can.
It's actually in the nursery. And stick it under the dirty diapers. That way we don't lose it.
Any other answers?
It's simple, but just walk away.
Yeah. I just imagine Nicole, she's all...
No, I imagine you're laughing Napoleon Dynamite.
Awesome. Awesome. Any other ideas? No? Now, I'm going to get a little bit complicated on this answer, okay? Because there's the general rule and the escalated rule, okay? The general rule is for just normal things. And we're not talking about child molestation. We're not talking about anything like that. We're talking about he did something that rubbed you the wrong way, or the person the wrong way, okay? So this is the general rule of that. First off, it'll go, don't listen to them. And make it known, I don't want any part of this. Leave me out of this. Second thing, tell them to take it up with the people involved, be it the pastor or someone else. If someone comes to you with some reason that some other person is offended, always go tell them to go take it up with that person. Who said that? Was it you or you? Or somebody said go back to the person that... Did you talk to the person, right?
I think he said, let's go talk to the pastor. And
right.
I think I said, did you talk to the pastor?
Right. Okay, so you got both kind of talked about it. Okay, so if it's just a person in the church, not the pastor... go talk to the person. Same thing is true for the pastor as well. You know, if you've got a tip with somebody, this should be between you and that person. This shouldn't be between me and you and that other guy over there. Whatever.
No, it's going to be between me, you, that guy, and all of Facebook.
Right? And actually, you joke. But seriously, we've actually experienced stuff with this where the pastor will do something that, you know, obviously it's wrong because they didn't think it was right. And so then they go share it on Facebook and it's just like, oh. And then all their dumb friends will go on there and comment, it's okay, sweetie. You were right. I don't know the situation, but it's okay because you were right. Okay. That's real helpful. Anyways. don't take up other people's offenses or defenses. This goes for either side, okay? Don't take sides when you're talking bad about my friend, or that person wronged you, you're my friend. You know, you don't need to take up offense or defense. See what I mean?
Yeah.
Get out of the situation. This has nothing to do with me. You need to go talk to that person. I'm out. Sometimes you can go to that person and say, look, this person has a problem with you. You might want to go and talk to them before this thing escalates. But sometimes saying that is a very bad idea because then it's just like you're gossiping about the person who's gossiping. See what I mean? So it's really just something that you have to use wisdom on. Wisdom and discretion.
I think also you have to look at who says it too.
Yeah.
It's somebody new, you don't know about it.
I mean, that is true.
Yeah. But still, I think if it's somebody new, a pastor should know because...
Problem person?
It represents the church.
Yeah.
You don't want that to keep on going.
Right.
Yeah,
I think that's a good point. When someone's new comes in, you know, it might be a good idea to talk to the pastor about it. Like, hey, this person who's had problems with all these other churches came here and now they're causing problems here. You just thought you might want to know about this.
Yeah.
Just FYI. You know.
Not that people go around from church to church and cause problems. Like,
no.
Never seen that.
No.
It's the drugs. It's always the drugs. Don't get caught in gossip, complaining, and backbiting. This will kill your spiritual life. Honestly, if you want to be very unhappy in life, do those two things. Otherwise, don't. And then the last thing here, forgive them for gossiping. Mm-hmm. And forgive the other person for what you overheard because you don't know the whole story. And even if you did, still forgive them. Mm-hmm. Forgive everyone, basically. If you start noticing a bad attitude, buddy, you hop on that like Chuck Norris on Lazy.
Yeah.
So there is no ministry of gossip, even if you are intending to comfort. This is what we do. I'm just trying to be the soundboard for that person. You know, oh, they just needed someone to talk to. Okay. That's called the Ministry of Gossip, and it actually doesn't exist. If you read through the whole Bible, you will never find it once. I understand that a lot of times people need comfort and they need encouragement. However, it can't happen in the context of gossip. It just can't. Sounds like his truck is having a really hard time. Really hard time. Do you hear it?
Like something in the attic. You guys hiding something?
So then there's the advanced cases, though. This is like, okay, I saw the pastor molest a child. I saw the pastor doing drugs in his office. I mean, something that's actually like, okay, hold on, pause. This is an illegal activity. What are we talking about? So, I mean, here's the thing, though, with this. You really got to consider the source, though.
Yeah.
Okay, but with that being said, let me go ahead here. First, if a pastor is accused, other leaders should do an investigation. Yeah. The pastor should not be in charge of their own investigation.
Right? No.
Not only that, but the person who's bringing the accusation should not be in charge of that. It needs to be people who are objective people. Okay, that means that they are in no way involved in the conflict. They are on a search finding quest. Okay, that's it. And that needs to be definitely, if there is no one who qualifies for this, then it needs to be someone from another church or another something that can be trusted. So I mean, some kind of the district or something. See, I mean something like that. If there's nobody objective that you can find. However, this needs to be done without everybody knowing what's going on, okay? Because of this. A lot of times there's false accusations, then there's people who gossip, then there's, I mean, go down the list of why this is a terrible idea. As few people as possible need to know about this, okay? So the next thing. Otherwise, the pastor needs to instantly talk to all those involved. If it's not the pastor in this escalated case, that's what I'm talking about here. The pastor needs to personally go and talk to these people if it's not the pastor who did it. Uh-huh. Example, I saw Chuck doing drugs, right? And so I tell Zach. So then Zach says, okay, we need to go talk to the pastor. So then we go talk to the pastor and say, look, I saw Chuck doing drugs. And so then the pastor goes and talks to him, he talks to me, and he talks to Zach. So I mean the pastor handles it because of an escalated situation, you know what I mean? Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. Okay. Once again, though, this is advanced cases. This is not the general rule. This you might never see happen in your entire life. Just to kind of let you know, it's not that common.
Be surprised.
I mean in the local church. I don't mean in the worldwide. I mean in the local church. Like, it happens all around the world, but the problem is you're probably not going to see it happen in Tularosa in your lifetime at this time in life. You know what I mean? Like, I mean, it could happen if all the stars are aligned.
Right.
Child abuse or molestation must always be reported. This is a thing that we could actually lose our license from as pastors. If this is admitted to us, we have to report it. That's actually the law.
It's mandated.
Right, and it's not like one of those things where, oh, well, pastor, whatever, confidentiality. Well, there is that, except for things like this.
Yeah.
Once you hit these kinds of things, there's nothing we can do about it. We are required by law to report it. Mm-hmm. So you too, I would highly recommend you guys who are not licensed pastors or ordained pastors or certified pastors, whatever. You who are not pastors, I would still highly recommend for you to report it. And here's what we do. It was just one time. It's not really their fault because of whatever. I don't want to ruin their lives. All these different excuses that we tell. Do what's right and report it. Okay? Worst comes to worst, they do an investigation and it turns out that nothing actually happened.
But it's better to be safe than sorry.
Better safe than sorry. Exactly right. What my point is.
You reported you said the police.
Yeah. Yes. Or CYFD or CPS or whatever. Just report it. Same goes for someone who's threatening suicide. The same thing goes for this too. You always want to report these things because you could save a life.
Right.
You know what I mean? This is something we don't really play around with. But also I want to say this, this is something that we have in our new membership course at the church, and I think it still applies to this. Friends can say more than acquaintances. If you're closer to someone, you're going to have an easier time saying something to them than if you're not. You know, like, let's say Grace and I are best friends. We're married even. And I see her do something if I'm her friend, I can go up and talk to her about it. Mm-hmm. Now, let's say her and Chuck hate each other. Chuck tries to go and tell her something. Well, she's not going to listen because they're not. See what I mean?
Yeah.
If you have a repertoire with somebody.
Rapport.
I knew that didn't sound right. If you have a rapport with somebody, it's going to be a lot easier to handle that situation. So, but on that note, false accusations can ruin lives.
Yes.
Even if somebody's proven not guilty, still it goes down. Yeah. And then other times, somebody is guilty. Everybody knows that they're guilty. And the judge says they're not guilty, and everybody still knows that they're guilty.
Yeah.
So, things like these stick. Don't forget that. So, some steps to healing that are just, real quick on this. Always act or not act based on the other's benefit, and do this with the spirit of patience. Well, they messed up. I need to go and talk to them. Maybe, but be patient. Maybe you should at this time, maybe you shouldn't. It's like when sometimes you'll see kids do something stupid, and you just have to have the patience to just let it slide. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Not every time that your kid messes up do you need to jump down their throat and tell and show them how they messed up and how, you know what I mean? And it's the same thing for adults too. Sometimes you're going to see somebody mess up and you just have to kind of bite your tongue and let it go. Does that make sense? So know if you're, and what people do is they try to make it a whole prophetic thing. If you really love them, you'll tell them the word of God and you'll set them straight. Yes, in a way, but if you really love people, you're going to talk to them in the same way God did. How many times did...
You're going to be patient with them.
Right.
Like God is.
Mm-hmm. How many times did Israel mess up before God sent them into exile? Mm-hmm. How many prophets did he send before God sent them into exile?
Mm-hmm.
How many warnings did he give before... You see what I'm saying? Yeah. Like, he worked with them and he was patient with them all the way up. You know, hundreds of years here. I think you can afford a couple days of patience. See what I mean? You see what I'm getting at? So always act or not act based on the other's benefit. Is this gonna be a good situation that I'm doing this, or is this gonna be a bad situation? So I mean, what am I really gonna bring about by this? And then never do anything out of bitterness. If you're just doing something to get vengeance on somebody, to get back at somebody, just don't even do it. Forgive them. This just kind of goes without saying. If you really want to have an impact on somebody's life, you have to forgive them for the stupid things that they've done. That's just how it goes. Address the issue. Sometimes we try and ignore things until they go away. Doesn't really work that well. You know what I mean? Address the issue in your heart. Address the issue in the person. But whatever it is, just make sure that the issue is resolved. You see married couples do this a lot, you know, where they'll get in fights or whatever, and it'll just kind of linger, and so then they won't address that problem, and it'll carry on to the next day, and all of a sudden they're having these fights based off this thing that happened months ago. Why? Because it was never addressed. You know what I mean? And what I mean by address the issue, I'm not saying, Zach, you did this. That was wrong. Apologize. That's not what I'm talking about at all. I'm saying, go to the person and say, look, this is really bothering me, and I just want to apologize for my role in it. You know, I felt like I could have handled it differently. You know what I mean? And whatever it is, I guess I'll just leave that one alone. Take someone else. If it's an escalated situation where it's not something you can just let go, it's something in the church that's going on that needs to be addressed, you know. Address it to them one-on-one first. Always address it to them one-on-one first. If it doesn't work out and they're not willing to listen to you, take someone as a witness, you know what I mean? Someone like, that you trust that is biblically grounded, okay? They might be able to see something in the issue that you're not. But don't take someone who's just going to side with you because you're homeboys. Don't do that. And then if it's at this stage, okay, personal offense, you weren't able to just look past it, something that actually needs to be addressed. You go and talk to them, they're not willing to listen. You go and take somebody else, and they're still not willing to listen. Then you take it to the church. What this means is you take it to the leadership of the church, okay? And they handle, and we talked about this last week, what the role of a pastor is in contrast to just a person of the church. They're the ones who are supposed to weed out the more elevated situations to try and bring peace to the situation. Okay, a pastor, and in these escalated circumstances, we aren't supposed to have a winner and a loser. We're supposed to have peace. See what I mean? We're supposed to make peace in a chaotic situation. We aren't supposed to make one person the winner and one person the loser. See what I mean? And that kind of goes against our logic, because when we get in fights, we always like to, well, I was right. See what I mean? Well, we're not
to take sides.
Right. And we're not looking for revenge in the situation. We're looking for peace in the situation. You know? I think a historical example would be great. World War I. Germany and France get in this fight. Obviously, it becomes a world war. At the end of the war, you know, France is pretty much, it's okay, France, you're fine. And then Germany is just given all the blame. They have to cover all the costs, all these things. And Germans just got really, really tired of it. They got fed up. They were treated like the bad guys in the situation. And nobody, you know, sided with them. It was all Germany's fault. And France was not to blame at all, even though they were poking the bear too. See what I mean? And so then, one of these people who's just pissed off enough, his name's Adolf Hitler, starts the Third Reich, and World War II gets started. See what I mean? Because they weren't seeking peace in the situation. They were seeking a winner and a loser. Germany was the loser, and France was the winner. See what I mean? All that does is enables another fight in the future. We're not looking for winners and losers. We're looking for peace. Okay? You work for a company and can sell goods to the church at a discounted price. What do?
Maybe see who buys the supplies for the church and let them know that, you know, you have these goods, and if they're interested, you can give it to them, maybe.
Okay. Any other ideas? Or were you done?
And if they're not a good price for the church, then forget about it.
Okay. Let's assume, for the sake of this argument, that it's cheaper than they're going to get it elsewhere. Let's just assume that. Because I think it kind of plays out better in a more area of conflict. Is that... what now?
But I would... I wouldn't let them go through me personally, I don't think.
Okay, why?
Because I think it would be a conflict of interest with me.
Okay.
So I would let them know that the company does these prices. And if they want to, you know, here's a name and number you can go to.
Okay.
Or a website or something.
All right. Anything else? Anyone else? I think that was a really good answer, Grace. Get another salesman from your company to make the deal. That's exactly what I would have done. You will lose out on a commission, but you won't become a profiteer. So, I mean... someone always talks about others every time they're around. What do?
Stop hanging around them.
Okay, let's make the situation more complicated. Your husband always talks about everybody else every time he's around. What do? Or wife. You guys will be wife, okay? You guys will be husband. You guys will be wife, okay?
You want them to talk, right?
Okay, sure, whatever. Whoever has an answer. Okay.
Well, you could always call Chuck and say, hey, have Michael work more days at the Oasis.
Oh. Oh.
I can't have him around here.
2 o'clock instead of 3. Keep it up until 8.
Nice. I'm Michael, and I approve this message.
Well, if I was
it's hard in a spouse situation.
Yeah.
It doesn't have to be a spouse. I'm just trying to make it more of like a what if you can't just go away. I mean, let's say it's Ben for you, because you guys live in the same house. It's something that you can't just go away. Okay, well, someone who's around all the time. Your mom, every time you're around your mom. I don't know, whatever, man. Just someone who you're around a lot.
One thing you could do is send the conversation in another direction.
Okay.
bring up other topics that don't involve people.
Hmm. And on that, you could start a new hobby with the person. You know, like, hey, let's play games. Hard to talk about people when you're having fun. Anybody else? I mean, you can do it, though, if you're talented enough.
I think that was a good one, you know, to restrict the conversation.
Yeah, I think it is, too. Yeah.
I think also maybe, like, make the conversation of, so you like talking about a lot of people, huh? Or, I've noticed
that conversation's not going to end well.
That conversation's not going to end well. The way that she said it.
So you like talking about people a lot.
You're kind of a jerk, huh?
I'm the D-bag, eh?
Jeez, Grace, calm down, huh?
So this is the fact that, you know, I noticed you have a lot of issues with a lot of people. You know, like,
and now I'm going to be one of them.
Right?
But who are you going to go to talk about me?
Right? Online.
Okay, that's an idea, Grace. Any other ideas?
can we just veto that one now?
Pastor said this 100 times. I think it's worth repeating again since, you know, Gracie said that terrible, terrible idea. I normally try to not discourage you guys' answers, but that really was a terrible answer. The way you say things, what you say, and the expression on your face.
Like you fell on those.
Yeah, you fell on all three.
I asked Michael this. I overthink things before I want to, like, you know, say something serious, and so I just make it come out terrible. It just comes out so terrible, and I'm like, oh, I thought about trying to say this so much, and it just
terrible. Huh. Well,
don't worry, Grace, you'll get there someday.
Hopefully.
Any other ideas?
Honestly, you know, confront them about it. You know, hey, just say like, hey, you know, I'd appreciate if you wouldn't talk about this to me.
Okay.
Or just kind of.
Yeah.
Get them away from it.
Yeah.
Don't involve me. Kind of leave me out.
Yeah. Okay.
One last thing I would bring up, probably how you could adjust this in a little better.
a little more tactfully?
is, okay, if you're hanging around this person, you probably do have a rapport with them, right?
Uh-huh.
So.
Well, let's hope so.
It's like what Randy said about whoever it is that whenever they get together, they gossip.
Yeah.
And they both realized it.
Yeah.
And so they made a mutual agreement that they probably shouldn't spend
packed
time together.
Okay. Can I do that as a spouse? I'm just kidding.
You say, wife goes one way, husband goes the other way.
We'll meet up in the middle for Valentine's Day, and otherwise we'll see you on Christmas.
But friendwise, it's really hard, though, because, like, I had this one friend that it was really hard because they would always gossip, and then I would gossip.
What was their name? Gossip. What did they talk about? Oh, tell us.
And, I told them, like, several times, you know, I don't want to really gossip whenever, you know, we're around. Let's talk about something else, you know? And, it would last a couple of days, and then we'd go straight back to gossip. And eventually, I would just kind of let them slowly drift away. Because it was really hurting my church life, you know? It was a conflict of interest.
Yeah. It's like, I'm glad you actually bring that up. Sometimes parents sabotage their kids by having them hang out with people who are just terrible influences on their kids. And they always say something like this, maybe my kid will be a good influence on them. Except... Nope. Paul actually warns about this. Bad company corrupts good morals. So you're sending out your child to fight a lion with a stick.
Yeah.
I mean, it's a terrible idea. Yeah. It's just a terrible idea. Oh, my kid's righteous. Okay. All right. Mm-hmm. Let's see how well that goes. Okay. So some good thoughts. What I would say... if it's someone like that, is I would actually say what Gracie and Nicole both said, but, you know, obviously more tactful than that. But I mean, you know, I think that you guys are you know, on it. If you try redirecting and it doesn't work after like a couple weeks and everything, and they just keep going back and everything, well, sometimes you just have to, you know, kind of lay it out there, you know. I really just don't really want to know about that. Maybe we could talk about something else, you know. The situation is going to dictate how you should say it. But just in a nice way, you know, let them know that you still care about them, we're still friends, you know, I just want to talk about something else. You know what I mean? Like, and they'll know you, you'll know them, you'll kind of know how to talk to them. Unless you're, you know, Gracie and you. I'm just kidding, Gracie. I'm just kidding. But as far as a smaller situation like this, ask them to stop if they won't avoid them. You know. So, anyways, you overhear people talking bad about you behind your back. What do you do? I'll actually tell you a funny story about this. My mom, she's getting ready to marry my dad. And she's in the bathroom, and she's getting ready to come out. And she overhears them talking about her. And she doesn't like confrontation. She's just kind of standing there like, what do I do? There's no way out. The way out is where they are. And so finally, after a few minutes, she's like, I'm coming out now. And she walks through to get out of there. Awesome. Just funny. Anyways, what do you do in that kind of situation?
Just go and tell him, I heard everything you said. I just wanted to know that I heard everything you said.
And I'll remember it.
And just walk away. Boy, they're going to feel so terrible.
A guilt tripper over here. Ugh. She must be a woman.
I don't know if it's either because I have a situation where this person was talking really bad about someone, and they're texting, and they accidentally text the person they're talking about. Long, huge thing. And
never do it in text.
Oh, and the person was like, that's me. And they're like, no, 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 no. And they still thought it was the friend. And they thought they weren't wrong at all. Some people, they just get in.
That was just a messy situation anyways, though.
After so long, you know. After so long of talking about that person, you think you're in the right.
I hate it when your phone company sends you reminders about stuff. God. And the hours of the day, it's like it's almost 9 or almost 8 o'clock. I just got it. Any other ideas?
I'll say this has happened to me a few months ago. I'm talking to one person. Well, this person overheard me talking to this person. Well, it was started a conversation, and I told this person, I really don't want to talk about this.
Uh-huh.
But that person kept on going on, and I kind of like, it's not the right place to talk about this.
Right.
You know, it was something to do with my class and all that stuff. Well, this person over here overheard it, and then she started spreading rumors around that I said it.
Oh.
I'm like, whoa, wait a minute. This is not good. So I'm going and telling my teacher, this is what's going on. So we went and we talked to her about it. We actually went to the girl and we talked to her, like, I don't know what you heard. I don't know where this comes from. Did you hear those words from me?
Yeah.
She's like, well, no, but, you know, and I'm like, why did you bring my name into this? I don't want to get involved into it. You know, don't put me as a middle person just because I was,
yeah.
You know. So she's like, well, I don't want to make any stuff like this, you know. Like, unless you're sure. I said it.
Yeah.
Don't get me involved. You know, it's sometimes you have to go. It depends on a person. You have to like stop before it goes somewhere.
Yeah.
You know, you just don't confront them.
And you know, on that note, sometimes
in a loving way, you know,
yeah.
Not like a hatred way. I'm gonna
right.
Punch you, you know?
But I would like to see you, you know, fight people out. You know, that'd be awesome.
But I took somebody with me.
Right. Right.
You know, I didn't go by myself. So.
And on that note, I think sometimes. The person needs to go back and tell the people, you know, sorry, I said this and it wasn't true. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Like, sometimes as a pastor, I think that it's a good idea to expect people to do that. You know, hey, you really caused a problem here. I think that you should go to those people and let them know that what you did was wrong, that what you said was not true.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Because otherwise, there's always going to be these things on the back of those people's, you know, minds.
That's true. I never thought
about that. You know, and sometimes it's better to just drop it. It really just depends on the situation. And I'm sorry. Anyways, anybody else? Anything else?
I guess it depends on what they're talking about. I mean, like if it hurts your, like on the situation with Diana at work, well, hurts her job.
Okay.
Know? And so that needs to be addressed. But say you're like...
Let's say a personal ministry matter.
Personal ministry matter? I think it depends on if it hurts your reputation or not. If it doesn't hurt your reputation, then I think say just drop it. But if it hurts your reputation, I think it needs to be addressed so it doesn't hurt your witnessing opportunities.
Hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I actually liked your answer more than mine. My answer was forgive them and pray for them, but then don't bring it up. And the reason why I said that is because oftentimes we try to guilt trip people when they've wronged us. You know what I mean? Like, and it doesn't actually resolve the issue. We're just upset with them. And that we want them to feel as bad as we feel. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? And sometimes we just do it for the wrong reasons. But with that being said, I actually like your answer more. I think sometimes we definitely do need to, you know, because sometimes the person is you know, a gossiping person.
Yeah.
And they're just gonna keep going,
Yeah.
You know, and situations like that do need to be addressed because fire does spread.
Right.
And then also what you said I think is relevant because sometimes they'll say something about you and it's like, well, that's actually not true, you know. And that's kind of a big deal, you know. Someone is involved in a church conflict. What do you do?
Stay away.
Blam. Keep your distance. You'll get sucked in.
Yeah.
And here's the thing that is increasingly important. In extremely escalated situations, okay, situations where the person leaves the church or is kicked out of the church, that kind of a thing where it's a really escalated thing, I would go a step further than that. Don't become friends with this person. Cut it off there and move on. See what I mean? Just move on. Because what happens is, first off, the person who was hurt in this, they're going to see you talking with them, and they're just going to assume, see what I mean, that you sided with them. Then also, eventually, you're going to get sucked into the conflict. You're going to get sucked into the attitudes. And see what I mean? Notice how John and Paul, and I think maybe Peter too. I don't know about Peter, but I know for sure John and Paul both mentioned people by name and said, don't hang out around with this person. Kick them out of the fellowship. Have nothing to do with them. Why do you think he said that? Because it spreads to other people. See what I mean? So if you know that somebody left a church on bad terms, see what I mean? Then cut that off before it grows too bad. So some personal irritants. What do you do in these situations? You go to a church and the worship is terrible. I mean, it is literally the worst thing in the world. Every time you hear the music team start, you literally want to throw up. And it's just like you have to talk yourself into going for the first part of service because the worship team is that bad. What do you do?
Well, then come later if you don't Yeah,
right. Okay.
He hated that bad.
Right.
Maybe sit in the back and pray through it.
Right. Pray through. See, that's funny because in the Pentecostal church.
No, you just go to the leader and just let him know what's on your face, right?
Whoa. That's funny because in the Pentecostal movement, they used to say about praying through when you're going through struggles. And so you're like, pray through. That's awesome. Any other ideas? I really liked your guys' answer.
Well, if you think, you know, like if you think you can contribute to it, maybe talk to the worship pastor about maybe getting on during worship. Like, you know, if you play the guitar and the guitarist, if they're like maybe offer your services.
You know what the worship pastor's really like when you just show up
at the worship practice.
Yeah, and announce them for your instruments in your microphone. But don't say it in a bad way. Like you say, hey, I see you have a worship team.
So I notice that you guys go on stage every week and you try to play things. Would you like to sound like music? Awesome. Normally I'm of the opinion just struggle through it because sometimes when we offer our services, it can, like Gracie was talking about, sometimes, not all the time. It's a good idea. I'm not knocking your idea. But sometimes it can be like you're just trying to micromanage their ministry. You know what I mean? And especially since the worship team isn't like, it's not like we're preaching the word, you know what I mean? It's something that we're just guiding people as they worship, you know what I mean? The focus isn't on us.
Right.
You know what I mean? So for that reason, I would say, maybe not. And then another thing is sometimes when we get on the team, we can want to try and start changing it. When the truth is that the worship leader is the one who sets the tone for the worship team, not the worship team.
Yeah.
See the difference?
Yeah.
And so what we do is we try to get our foot in the door so we can start changing things, but that's actually not our job.
Yeah.
See what I mean? It's like associate pastors. Do you know it is not our job as associate pastors to set the tone for a church? We don't set vision for a church. We don't tell people, we don't set people on a course in the church. We don't do any of that. This is the pastor sets the tone of the church. He guides them in the process. He's the leader. He leads people in the process. We, people like us, Chuck and I, we help him do that.
Yeah.
That's hard to do as a leader, because what you want to do is you want to, well, this isn't very efficient. Let's change that. Get your hands off that. You're the associate pastor, not the senior pastor. And the problem is too many associate pastors try and fight the senior pastor for leadership. But you're not leading the church. You are helping the pastor lead the church.
Yeah.
You're doing whatever's necessary to make his job easier. So,
make it worse.
Right.
Right.
Shallow sermons. You're going to church and the sermons are just terrible. I mean, we're not talking about he's not a good speaker. We're talking about, like, it's just shallow. You know what I mean? Like, just shallow.
Like bad?
Not bad theology. Just you're not being fed at all.
Oh,
at any point of the service are you being fed?
It's stale.
Yes, very stale, and it's like eating the same meal for the same day. Like fajitas, great meal. But if you eat it for the same for every single day for months, it's just not that great of a meal.
Well, that I would say.
You know what I'm talking about.
You're not supposed to necessarily go to church to get your feed for the week, you know?
Okay.
So just make sure you're keeping up on your Bible studies and everything yourself, and still go to church because you need the fellowship and such as well.
Okay.
I mean,
okay. So just to clarify, not to critique your view, just to clarify your view, are there reasons or circumstances that you say would go against what you just said, or is that just pretty much the this is what you should do for shallow sermons?
I don't think you should leave the church over it. And I don't think you should go up to the pastor and say, you need to do more studying in your...
Awesome.
Because I'm sure he's doing as much as he can, you know?
Yeah.
You know, you could really take some hints from Joel Osteen.
Like, I'm sure if he didn't want to preach, he wouldn't be up on the stage, you know what I mean? So I'm sure he's doing as much as he wants, I mean, as much as he can, to provide you with what he can, but you shouldn't leave a church because you're not getting fed, because the pastor's just supposed to kind of lead you in the direction of the church, not feed your weekly dose.
Hmm. I mean, I agree with you on part, but another part of me says, you know, sometimes churches have no room for new ministries. They have no room for fellowship. Everybody just goes through their set things. It's like a clock.
Yeah.
And then the sermons are real shallow, and so it's like, well, sometimes, I don't know. If you're wanting to get plugged into ministry, if you're wanting to do something for the kingdom, if you're wanting to actually learn something, see what I mean? It's a complicated issue. I don't know.
Maybe.
I'm not disagreeing with you. Yeah. I'm just not sure.
Yeah. Maybe you can go to the pastor and ask him if you can start a ministry yourself, you know, like a young adults ministry or something, you know, to try to bring more enthusiasm to the church.
Hmm. It's just a bit of a slippery situation, I
especially
think.
Especially if it's the only church in town.
Yeah.
Sometimes that happens.
Yeah.
You can't just not go to church, you know what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah. It's a hard one.
Just pray through.
Yes, just sit in the back. Just from worship and through the sermon, just keep on praying.
Have your own little Bible study in the back.
Well, there was something else I was going to say, but I forgot it. Any other ideas on that one?
Maybe it's just the person, you know? Maybe you can go around and say, hey, what do you think of today's sermon today? You know,
like, I see this going poorly.
You have to...
Check. Wasn't it terrible today?
You have to be really careful on how you word it, and you have to be very careful on how you give your answers. But maybe see if it's not just.
But it seems kind of like you're opening yourself up.
Yeah, it does. It does. It really does.
That's why I said you have to be really careful.
So careful that maybe it doesn't even happen.
Yeah.
Well, I think part of this that I'm struggling with is, I guess, the attitude behind it. If you leave a church with this idea that I'm just so much smarter than the pastor, I'm so much more spiritual, versus if you've been doing this for years, you're not learning anything. The people don't like you. You just feel like you're ostracized from the church. Maybe.
There are a lot of churches that, in their teaching and stuff, they just stay at that baby Christian level.
Yeah.
They don't expand.
And it's really a hard question. Sometimes people just hop to another church because they're looking for something exciting.
Right.
Yeah.
But
is
it the right
that
thing?
Challenges them.
Right. Yeah. And is it the right thing? And I guess whatever your answer on this, prayer needs to be the foundation of any decision you make.
Yeah.
If you stay or if you go, it has to be because you prayed about it and God's directing you.
I think also to see if it's not new, it's, are they having new people come and stay at the church, you know? If they're having new converts, then maybe it's just you. You know what I mean?
These are some good thoughts, guys. Too traditional or too progressive. Like, for instance, example of too progressive, you know, lights for the
fog machines,
the light shows, you know, electric guitars, guitar solos, that kind of stuff. Tradition would be only hymnals.
Organ.
If there is an instrument, it's going to be like one, maybe two at tops. It's going to be organ or piano, all
right.
And maybe a guitar, usually. It's going to be everyone dresses up in suits, everything's, you know, kind of like more business. Whereas in a progressive, it's going to be like people are wearing jeans. You know, so what do you do if you go to a church and it's too traditional or too progressive? What do you do?
I don't think it should have any waiver on you leaving or bringing the attention to somebody unless it's hurting the progress of the church.
Okay.
You know what I mean? If the tradition are keeping people away from the church, well, maybe you need to spend some time in prayer to see if you should leave.
Mm. Yes, I like that, because sometimes what happens is people just kind of get their feelings hurt about the situation itself. You know what I mean? Like, this isn't a show. I mean, this is just a show, and so they go and tell everybody else how terrible that church is. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like Rick Warren, for instance. Some people have a very good opinion of him, some people have a very bad opinion of him. But a lot of times people just take what somebody else said about him versus what they heard from him and their view and why they have that view. You see what I mean?
Yeah.
And I think that it goes the same with progressive and traditional. Oh, well, they just use hymnals, those kinds of people with the pews still.
A lot of times if it doesn't satisfy our personal taste, then we tend to reject it, even if it is doing a good job.
Right. Even if
it is reaching people.
Yeah.
They're not true Christians anyways. True Christians sit in pews. It's a joke. It's a joke, everybody. Okay. No gifts of the Spirit or gifts of the Spirit. What do you guys think about this one?
think it depends on how much you know about it.
Yeah.
Okay, could you explain what you mean?
I mean, the church that I used to go in Moldova, they use no gifts of the spirits. I had no clue about it.
Uh-huh.
You know what I mean?
Right.
So, I was okay with it, because I didn't know any better.
If you went back now...
Oh, it would bother me.
Okay. And would bother you enough to leave? Or
no, not to leave. I think I would, like, not feel sorry for the people, but I think I would just pray that God will open some kind of way to bring somebody in, just to at least to, like, to get them to know what this is, at least.
Uh-huh.
You know what I mean? Just open some kind of door so people would start learning about the gift of the Spirit. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Any other ideas? Nicole popped her head out.
Well, I've seen extremes in this both directions.
Okay.
You know, you've got those who think that if your church has gifts of the Spirit, then you're dancing with serpents and rolling down the aisles and all of that, you know.
Oh, yeah, we have that.
And then you actually have those that try to do that. I've seen it both. I think there needs to be moderation. The gifts should be allowed.
Right.
But don't try to make up your own gifts for your own thing.
Like throwing people out of wheelchairs?
And holy urination and gold dust and...
Yeah. Oh, so many things.
So many things.
So many
things. I think if you go into a church with no gifts of the Spirit, maybe ask the pastor, you know, why?
Yeah.
Okay.
You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Not in a bad way, but, you know, just conversation. Just sit down for lunch and say, hey, just, you know, curious.
Is this something you're pursuing, or is this something that you don't care about, or is this something that, kind of stuff?
Yeah.
Okay.
And if it's something that he does not want in that church, maybe it's something that you should consider maybe praying about leaving, or praying about staying and trying to... Change his mind. not change his mind as in talk to him and say, hey, you need to do this, you need to do this, but, you know, kind of pray for it to change, like Diana was saying, pray that something comes to happen.
Okay.
For it changes.
One thing that I've seen people try to do is try and hijack the service by their gifts of the Spirit show the pastor the error of his ways. This is how us spiritual people do. You know?
Well, I mean...
I've been in the church a long time.
If you go into my country and start speaking in tongues, they'll think you're evil. You got the devil in you, and you're like, what in the world is going on with that person? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because they don't know.
Yeah. Yeah.
She's the devil! I mean, I can see that happening.
Yeah. Oh, boy.
She's worse than a Russian.
No, it just makes me think of what Jesus said in the gospel, where they're all like, oh, this is of the devil, this is of the devil. And he's like, blasphemy of the Spirit's not a good idea, guys. Just FYI.
Yeah.
Oh, my gosh. Anyways, I'm getting off topic anyways. My personal opinion is I don't want to be somewhere where the gifts of the Spirit are intentionally restricted.
Right.
The Holy Spirit means too much to me. And I'm not there for a club, and I'm not there to go through the motions, and I want to see people. Here's the thing. I'm smart enough to figure stuff out on my own. I don't need a pastor to stand up there and tell me everything. I can figure it out on my own. I don't need them. See what I mean? I need fellowship with the body. That's what I need. See what I mean? And what enables us to have that fellowship? What enables us to serve people? What enables us to love? What enables me to see that I need other people rather than thinking that I can just do it all by myself? The Holy Spirit. See what I mean? A Christian life without the Holy Spirit, that's preaching Jesus without the Holy Spirit. That's exactly what the Gospels didn't do. They always say, Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, went. You know what I mean? I think that when they were saying Jesus, Holy Spirit just kind of included in that. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I mean, honestly, we live in the age of technology. You can find out answers on your own by just by going online.
Yeah.
See what I mean? You don't need some highly exalted pastor who has all the answers. See what I mean? Do you? You need a loving pastor who's there for you, right? You need a shepherd. You need an overseer. See the difference?
Right.
Pastors aren't supposed to be the smartest guy on the block. They're not supposed to have all the answers. They're supposed to serve and love and guide you to do the same. And we need the Holy Spirit to do that. See what I mean? To me, the issue of the Holy Spirit is too big of an issue to drop. You know what I mean? And I'm of the opinion if the Holy Spirit's not welcome, I'm not welcome.
Right.
You know what I mean? Because I feel like without the Holy Spirit, the church wouldn't exist today.
Exactly.
That's my own personal opinion. It's something I can't budge on. It's secondary to salvation alone for me. My own opinion.
And kind of before we move on, I just kind of have something to add.
You can add.
Just... from personal experience, churches that don't really use the gifts of the Spirit, it feels like it's rushed. It feels like the whole service is just rushed.
Yeah, I know what you're talking about.
Like they're just trying to get done, trying to get people out of
there. Yeah, it's like a...
Also,
how well can we do it?
Yeah.
A balance.
Yeah, like Jack was saying. Okay, so. Dressy or not dressy? Pews or chairs? What do you guys think?
Doesn't really matter
to me. So you wouldn't do anything one way or another?
No.
Do you really care? Okay, all right.
I mean, like, if everybody's dressy, I'd probably be dressy,
well,
too.
Yeah, exactly.
And if everybody's not dressy, if I like being dressy, I would probably dress down.
That's what I was going to say.
Yeah, I really... I would probably dress down a lot if people were dressed down, but if I liked being dressy, I'd probably dress up every once in a while, but not all the time, just so that way I wouldn't stick out, you know?
Yeah. And I've talked about this when I was teaching. I purposely do not dress up for the sole reason that we have a cult right behind our church that dresses up.
Oh,
so yeah. I have made a purpose in not doing that. And then the second thing is a lot of people around here real caught up with the whole Jewish thing.
Yeah.
You know?
Well, and another thing is because of the area that we're in.
Yeah.
If you're going to dress up, you're not going to relate to the people.
Yeah.
They're going to see that
as a schism between
you.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, and with the whole legalism thing, like I was saying with the Jewish thing and the Catholic thing and everything, religion kind of pushes people away, like Chuck just said. So sometimes I feel like in this area, I purposely and instinctively do not wear dress up.
Yeah.
So, anyways, so just some in conclusion ideas of discipleship. First off, disciples are Christians. Disciples grow and are teachable. Disciples strive for good relationships with God and others. Disciples are servants to people. This is what we've been talking about. Remember, we've been talking about discipleship for the past couple months now. This is the conclusion of that discussion. Tonight we're ending the mini-series of discipleship. We have done it. High five, all of you. And this is the idea behind it. Disciples are Christians. To be a Christian and not be a disciple of Jesus, you're kidding yourself. See what I mean? Oh, I'm a Christian. Are you seeking after God? Are you actively involved in other people's lives? Are you in a church? I mean, what's the situation there? Disciples grow and are teachable. You don't get a hard heart if you're a Christian. You struggle, but at the end, you're always going to side with God because bitterness is not the way of a disciple. A disciple strive for good relationships with God and others. Disciples are servants to people. This is the essence of discipleship. And I wanted to leave you with this verse, Romans 12:18. If possible, so far as it depends on you, be at peace with all men. As taken from the New American Standard, updated. Really, I think that kind of summarizes the idea of discipleship. Really, everything that we've talked about. We talked about, you know, lust and greed and pride. We talked about power. We talked about, you know, church problems. We talked about all these different things. And I think that it really all comes down to this. If possible, so far as it depends on you, be at peace with all men. Jesus said pretty much the same thing in a different way. He said it like this. The two greatest commandments are these. Love God and love your neighbor. Basically this. So, question of the week. Why does the church need the Holy Spirit, in your opinion? Or if read the Bible, and what do you think the Bible has to say about this? Why does the church need the Holy Spirit?
Well,